It's a 5-year agreement, right, that gives the nuclear company access to warp speed, to a platform. And Jonathan, I'll start with you. What is it that this software platform and technology allows you to do? Or what does it allow you to accelerate?
Yeah, great question. We have built 2 reactors in this country in the last 30 years. And the last 2 we built were down in Georgia. We had 10,000 people on that construction site at peak, and hundreds of thousands of pages of documents. With the full force and weight of Palantir, we're going to be able to, you know, give our frontline teams the best technology this country has to offer. And I can tell you and assure you there will be no construction site the nuclear company runs where we're expecting our teams to manage those projects with paper. So bringing the full force and weight of all their tools to automate systems so that we can get real-time information and update to our frontline teams to give them every shot to perform on the ground on time, on budget, and deliver a project.
Mike, when I think about warp speed, I think about the defense industrial base. This is a different and the latest example or initiative within warp speed. Why was it important to partner with a nuclear company?
Well, it is our first deployment into the nuclear space, but it is intimately connected to U.S. national security. The fact of the matter is we cannot win this strategic competition with China unless we revitalize our ability to build nuclear technology in general and reactors in particular, which is why we are so excited about this partnership with the nuclear company. And put aside the complementary capability that each company brings to the partnership, I think there's a strong mission alignment between Jonathan's team, between my team, between Palantir and the nuclear company. Both of these companies want America to dominate, to control the commanding heights of critical technology. And so nuclear is absolutely part of that, which is why we're excited to be in this space. We intend to put the full force and weight of Palantir and everything we've learned through the years into this partnership. And I'm incredibly excited about what not only this means for both of the companies, but what it means for America.
Jonathan, this is $100 million or more over a period of 5 years. But for you, in the context of your company, its current operations, money raised, that's a significant outlay. It clearly is a conviction bet that it will help you achieve real-world deployments faster. Is that a correct interpretation?
Oh, yeah, Ed, this is the high conviction bet for this company. We're all chips on black, center of the table, spinning the wheel here with Palantir. But I would say, in all seriousness, we're doing it with the best in the world. There is no company, not only in this country, but I would argue maybe on the globe, that has the capability Palantir has to offer. And so for us, building out that platform with Palantir day one is something that's uniquely special and an opportunity for us. But it's also been done. Look at Anduril, who built the backbone of their company with warp speed. You all are working with Airbus and others now. We're fortunate to be in that camp of companies that are going to go into that warp speed program. And I think for us, just putting everything we have into the Palantir organization so we, again, can ensure that our teams are unified on the ground and have the tools and technology to win. But there's no better partner we could pick than Palantir.
Jonathan, could we just talk about the basics of the nuclear company today, where you stand operationally and what your goals are over sort of medium and long-term horizons?
Yes, so we're a nuclear deployment platform. In the Western world, you have a bunch of companies designing reactors. And we think we have great legacy reactors that are operating today, and we have great new reactors that are being designed by a lot of startups that are coming to market. What the Western world does not have is we do not have a full stack deployment arm. What do I mean there? Take all those engineering and design drawings and get them in physical form on a construction site. That's what we're here to do. So if you're any company out there that wants to put a reactor in the field, you call us. That's our job. We're going to be living in RVs on construction sites. Our team is going to be those SEAL teams flying in to get the job done and build on a construction site, which is totally different than a business of going to design reactors and create different types of designs for reactors. So what we're bringing to market is complementing all these other companies that you might be reading about in the market. And we're just that execution arm that wants to go deliver on the ground.
Mike, when I think about warp speed, it's a Palantir-based software platform that is used by many companies I interact with, Anduril, Saronic. more closely and directly aligned with defense technology. Earlier in this conversation, you put this in the context of the national security interest. Just in aggregate, what is the impact that Warp Speed's having, and why is this a national security discussion?
Well, I think it is how we revitalize not just a defense industrial base, but an American industrial base, right? If you think about it in terms of a relative competition with our primary geopolitical threat, China, we can't win merely by throwing more money and more human beings at the problem. That's sort of a losing bet. We have to leverage our asymmetric advantage, which is innovation and AI-enabled software innovation. So applying that to the entire American industrial base, I think, is how we begin to build things faster, more quickly. As Jonathan mentioned, it shouldn't take over a decade to build a reactor in this country. That's not just a consequence of overregulation, though that is a key variable. It's about liberating the human beings who are involved in producing these things day to day to focus on their most important task rather than trying to find a piece of paper somewhere or an Excel spreadsheet. It's about allowing them to focus and maximizing their productivity. That's what we're seeing with our deployment of Warp Speed in other spaces. That's what makes me so bullish about this partnership. And that's ultimately, again, how we keep this country strong, secure, and ahead of all of our geopolitical rivals.
Yeah, Mike, and to piggyback
on. Oh, please, jump in. Please.
Well, what I would say is that this is absolutely a national security concern, and we should all be deeply concerned that China in the next few years is going to become the largest nuclear power producer on planet Earth. They will pass the U.S. for the first time since the history of nuclear power was invented. This is unacceptable. We have a president who's leading out front, calling for the private sector to step up and get a backbone. Our president said, let's go triple our nuclear fleet. He's absolutely right. If we're going to win the AI race, we need a lot of raw power. If we're going to win the advanced manufacturing race, we need a lot of raw power. We have got to build. We've got to stop, get out of the laboratory, get out of the PhD programs of thinking how we can tinker to design something new. There's no way to code this into existence on a construction site. What we're using Palantir's platform for is taking those hundred thousands of pages of documents that were required to build those last two projects here in the U.S. and digitizing those so that when supply chain delays are happening, our teams on the front lines are aware of it. We're giving updates to our team on the front line, using large language models and AI for what they're good at. Put all this data into a data lake. Allow us to get predictive analytics out to those electricians and welders and pipe layers on the ground. Like he was saying, if we're gonna compete with China, it's not gonna just be brute force. Yes, the American spirit with technology, and it's our job to get those frontline teams that technology.
Mike, your assessment of this administration and how it is approaching nuclear capacity in this country. You feel that they are providing the factors and environment that you need to make progress in your partnership?
100%. I think the executive orders we've seen out of the Trump administration are incredibly encouraging. I think the leadership we have and the expertise we have in the cabinet on these issues, at the Department of Interior, at the Department of Energy, these are world-class people. So I'm very optimistic about the direction we're going. And I think we finally, as a country, in increasingly a bipartisan manner, gotten out of this sort of devotion or this sort of anti-nuclear bias that we've had for too long. People recognize there is no future, whether it comes to AI or just meeting the energy needs of average Americans, without a reinvestment and a renaissance in nuclear technology. So this, all of this combines to make me incredibly optimistic about the future and why I think this partnership is going to be at the forefront of something really big for America.
Mike, Jonathan, there is nuclear in the context of domestic capacity and how it ensures those industry and strategic priorities you outlined. Then there's nuclear in the context of Iran. I have to ask you both for your kind of reaction, and if you can, put into context your partnership of what we saw in U.S. strikes on key Iranian nuclear sites in the last week. And Mike, why don't you kick us off?
Well, listen, I think it was good for deterrence, not only in the Middle East, but globally. For decades, the Iranians have used the cover of diplomacy to covertly advance their nuclear program. But ultimately, there are two things that are going to ensure a semblance of stability and peace in a region that has defied our past efforts to impose stability and peace upon it. One is a credible, conventional, and strategic deterrent, which is why it's so important that we rebuild our defense industrial base in order to give credibility to our deterrent. And the second is the framework of the Abraham Accords and our ability to build off that historic level of rapprochement between Israel and the Sunni Arab Gulf states. And the thing that unites those at times strange bedfellows, the long pole in that tent, if you will, is the shared threat of the Iranian regime, the leading state sponsor of terrorism.
Jonathan.
Yeah, and where I'll jump in on that is to say there's a clear distinction between how you harness nuclear for power and nuclear for what we're seeing overseas as a potential weapon. I think it's important for your viewers that you know, when we think of nuclear, 100 operating reactors in the U.S., roughly 100 over decades, not one person in the U.S. has died from radiation fallout. So even Three Mile Island, that, you know, if you look back at the stories in the 80s, the technology failed exactly the way it was supposed to. No one as a result, you didn't see radiation fallout. We are the best nuclear operators in the world. We need to get back to building, because if we don't build nuclear power plants, it's China and Russia that are doing that. And so, yes, there's a clear distinction between nuclear power and then the other type of the threat category. But I think it's important for the viewers because it is something that's held this industry back for decades, and we can't be scared of it. You don't get scared when you fly on a plane. You don't get scared when you get in a 2,000-pound metal car, but you still do it every day. We have the best operators on planet Earth. Call Joe Dominguez at Constellation. Call Duke. Call Southern Company. These are great operators that do it very safely. We can operate nuclear in this country very safely, high quality, and we got to get back to building nuclear power plants and operating for this country.
Jonathan Webb, CEO of the nuclear company, and Mike Gallagher, head of defense at Palantir. Thank you both for your time. Really appreciate it.